Mr. John Pereira, and he has also his colleague Mr. Ibrahim Kistak with him, and the stage is yours.
Yeah, thanks a lot for the invitation and that I can be here today. My name is John Pereira, and today I'm going to show you how to hack the current Google Chrome and how to actually exploit websites that are using transport encryption like SSL. Before we start, I want to say one, two words about my background, where I come from and what I do. So I'm the co-founder of SecBiz IT Security. We are a German cybersecurity company located in Cologne. And yeah, we focus on creating individual security concepts for companies, for industrial concerns, etc. And we also do a lot of research and ethical hacking. And this is actually my background, where I come from. So I teach myself cybersecurity because I always loved cybersecurity and I still love it. And for everybody today who is about to start doing cybersecurity, do it, because it never gets boring. And yeah, so my first project was actually hacking the US Army, because during this time in my country there was no law for hacking, and I was able to do it and make a video. And after that I contacted them, and they fixed it. And this was like my first step in the cybersecurity business. And this video gone viral, so I got a lot of projects from that and started doing it professional. And now I'm over 16 years in the cybersecurity business and still focused on ethical hacking. So I like to hack websites, software and industrial systems. This is my preferred target. And today we focus on software, especially browser software. Yeah, and one very important point to say is I'm an ethical hacker. So everything I do to help people, I do for research, I do it for fun, but I don't do it to damage people. And especially when it comes to browser vulnerability, you can do a lot of damage. So this is important to point this out. Everything that I'm going to show today is for research purposes. It's not to damage anybody. So in the meanwhile, I help to secure products from Apple, Nokia, Siemens, eBay, Microsoft, Google, PayPal, and many more. So these are our customers from SecBiz. And yeah, let's start. So why would you hack a web browser? This is like, I think this is a question many people have. And I hear this question quite often. And I think hacking web browsers is one of the most interesting things you can actually hack. Because web browsers are like the biggest target. Because, I mean, who of you doesn't use a web browser? Please raise the hand. This is why. So browser attacks are a lethal weapon in cyber war, because the good attacks remain invisible. That means when I attack you, you will not see it. You will not notice it. This attack is completely invisible for the victim. And this is why it's so dangerous. But not only because of this. Also, everyone is using a web browser, yeah? Just like we stated. We use it on our phone, we use it on the iPad, we use it on the MacBook, we use it on a Windows laptop, we use it on a computer. Everybody is using a web browser on a daily basis. And there's no company where no web browser is used. So, when I can exploit your web browser, that means I'm getting full access to your device that you're using right now. So, if I send you a link which contains malicious code that actually triggers a crash in your browser and makes it execute my own code, I instantly have full access to your device. So that means everything I have to do to hack your device or to hack your company is to send you a single email. And I can send this email to everybody in your company. So I can send this email to your secretary and I say, this is my CV, have a look at it. And in the moment when she opens the email, she's already compromised, so there's no way back. She opens the email and I have full access. This is how browser hacking works. And this is why browsers are also very interesting targets for evil people. because hacking a single device is enough to penetrate your whole business infrastructure. If you have a secretary who's victim of a browser attack and she clicks or he clicks on the link, I have access to your internal network. I have access to at least one computer in your internal network, which leads me to get more access in your internal network. So this is like the first step and also the last step I have to do to compromise your company. Because when I have access to a single computer, I can start attacking the network, I can start doing man-in-the-middle attacks, I have all options. So this is why many of these browser engines and browser creators actually do a lot to protect against this kind of stuff. Because like back in 2010, there was like a big trend in the cybersecurity community to hack web browsers, and everything started with, you probably guessed it, Internet Explorer. Yeah, so because people started to fuzz Internet Explorer, what is fuzzing, we talk about this later, but people started to attack Internet Explorer and find vulnerabilities in it and use it to attack companies. Yeah, so how do companies actually protect against these hackers? We have four major browser engines. We have Gecko, which is the browser engine of Firefox. We have Trident, which is the browser engine of Internet Explorer. And we have WebKit, which is the browser engine of Safari, for example, but also sometimes for Chrome. And we have Presto, which is the browser engine of Opera. I think no one is using Opera, but I just wanted to state it. So these companies who create these browsers and provide them for us, many of them are doing bug bounties. So I think many of you already heard of bug bounties or even participated in bug bounties. A bug bounty is a program of a company when they say, if you find a vulnerability in our software, we pay you for that. Yeah. So a good example is Google. They pay from 60K to 100K in their special bug bounty programs where you can find vulnerabilities in Chrome. And why do they pay so much? Because it's worth it. Because it means when you have a vulnerability in a browser, you can either sell it for 60K or 100K to Google and help them to fix it, what we actually do, or you could sell it on a black market where you actually get much, much more money. We have companies like Zero Day Initiative who actually invest in this. So they spend a lot of money on exploits to get more power, and they resell these exploits, for example, to governments or to other people who actually abuse this kind of tool or this kind of script. And the prices on the black market are pretty high for browser exploits. So if you want to buy a browser exploit on the black market, you have to have a lot of money or you have to find it by yourself. But what does that mean for us? For us, it means that we actually run in a great risk, because the first risk is if I get more money on the black market than from Google, it's basically the same for the hacker. If the hacker is not an ethical hacker, he will choose the customer who provides more money, of course. So this is why we have a lot of exploits on the black market, because many hackers don't even care. They say, if I put this much time in it, and it's a lot of work to find these kind of bugs, but we talk about this later. If they say, if I put like 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, 4 months in finding a security vulnerability, I will not let me pay 60K for it. It's not enough. So this is why they decide to sell it on the black market, because they actually want to get their time paid. I don't say this is a good thing, and I don't say I do this. I never sold to the black market. But I say this is a risk, because it's absolutely understandable that these people sell to the black market. I say in the case of Google, okay, they offer quite a lot of money, because I mean 60K to 100K for one exploit, it's not typical. Yeah, you have other companies like Mozilla, or you have Apple, where you don't really know what you get when you when you report this vulnerability. So they have these kind of bug bounties, but they don't tell you how much money you get when you report the vulnerability. So some people, they get like, I don't know, 5,000 euro. Some people get 6,000 euro. Some people get 200 euro. Some people get a thank you, and we already fixed this vulnerability in the morning, and you just reported it. Oh, what a surprise. Yeah, everything can happen. So this is why many people decide to directly go to the black market, because they know they get their money. So browsers are not easy to hack anymore, but it's not impossible. Like back in the days, you have just, I mean, there were vulnerabilities in browsers every day. So many people are hacking web browsers because they know it gives you power. It gives you the power to access basically every desktop computer in the world, as long as you have the possibility to send this person an email or make this person click on a link. Yeah, so it gives you power in the first run. Many people are interested in the power. The other thing is it's worth a lot. So just like we said, it's worth a lot. So it's kind of gold digging what people do when they look for browser exploits. Yeah. So because it's a gold mine, of course, because these browser exploits are worth a lot. And I would say they're even much more worth than the money. So a browser exploit is much more worth than 100K. Because imagine what it means if you have the possibility to access every desktop computer in the world, to get into every company in the world, to get any information you want. This is much more worth than 100K. So we start talking about fuzzing, intelligent fuzzing. So first of all, I think many people already know what fuzzing is. Maybe some of you already use it. If you don't use it yet, consider it. Fuzzing means mutation. So basically, we mutate input data for an application to a level where it triggers a memory corruption in the target application. There are other ways of fuzzing. So for example, I can also fuzz for web vulnerabilities. I can fuzz for SQL injections. I can fuzz for cross-site scripting. But this is not the kind of fuzzing I'm talking about. I'm talking about completely mutation fuzzing. So a good example would be if you use Photoshop and you open a JPEG file in Photoshop. Photoshop expects this to be a regular JPEG file and tries to load it. But now if I start the fuzzing, I start swapping bytes in this file. So I start swapping random bytes, I start deleting bytes, I start adding bytes, just completely random in the file. So the file gets like kind of broken. And if this file is broken, in many cases, Photoshop cannot load it anymore. So I would say in the most cases, you get the message, this file cannot be opened. But in other cases, Photoshop crashes because it tries to load this mutated file. And this byte swapping leads to a crash in the application. And I mean, many of you probably know, if you have a crash in an application, you're not, in many cases, you're not that far away from a working exploit. Yeah? So the crash is the first thing that you need if you want to write an exploit for a software. Yeah? So if I want to hack Photoshop, I first have to crash it somehow. And this is where the fuzzing starts. So I want to show you a really simple example. There's a fuzzer, it's called Radamza, and it's open source. And everything it does is just like super random mutation of data. So we have this sample string, hello Riga. And yeah, I mean, this could be anything now. It could be a file, but in this case, it's a string. And I want to show you what a fuzzer does to a file. So imagine we have a text file, and this is the content of our text file. It's hello Riga. And now I'm going to show you what the fuzzer does to it. So what we now do is we do a simple pipe. We say hello Riga, and we pipe it to our fuzzer. And then it looks like this. Nothing happened because it's random. Now it looks like this. Now it's just like twice, you know? Now it's nothing. Now it looks like this, and we get some fancy special characters. So what you see is like it randomizes the data, like it adds data, it removes data, it just like mutates the data. And this is basically what fuzzing does. It mutates data. And if we do the same thing to a JPEG file, this is how we crash. So this is how we crash Photoshop. We start with these mutations, and we see what happens. So if I want to find a vulnerability in Photoshop, I would now go for it. If I want to use Radamza, I would create like, I don't know, 10 billion JPEG files, and I would definitely have a crash. Maybe even after 1,000 files, you have a crash. It really depends on how often it already got exploited. And you start with the fuzzing, And then you collect the crashes that you have, because every crash is unique. Some crashes are not exploitable, though. You have crashes that are like null pointer dereferences. You have crashes that are just like accessing an address that you can never override. So you have many crashes that are completely worthless, with the exception of denial of service. So if you have like a web server running and you can crash it, of course you can do damage with this. But this is not the kind of attack we are looking for, because we are looking to turn this crash into a real code execution and execute our own shellcode in the memory. So, yeah, I think the concept of fuzzing is clear in the beginning, and this is what I would call dump fuzzing, because it just does really random stuff to our input, and we cannot really control it, and there's no guarantee that when I pass a JPEG file to this, that in the end it's still a JPEG file, that it still has a JPEG header, that it's still like detected as JPEG file. Yeah, I will have many files, just like I said, that cannot be loaded. And this is why we do intelligent fuzzing. So intelligent fuzzing means, so yeah, just like I said, there are many, many different fuzzers, and you still find a lot of vulnerabilities with this random fuzzing. So I bet if every one of you is starting to fuzz Photoshop today with this method, some one of you is going to find the exploitable vulnerability. But this is just the first step. So random fuzzing still works, but not for browsers. Why not for browsers? So let's go back in time. When we had Internet Explorer and all these Internet Explorer vulnerabilities, it was very easy to find new vulnerabilities, because you basically just generated random HTML documents and put them into a mutation, and then sometimes you have a crash. But this is not what works anymore today. So you cannot find vulnerabilities anymore today with dump fuzzing in browsers. It doesn't work anymore, because they all have like this rendering engines we talked about, and these rendering engines don't accept this kind of malformed data. So this is why we have to find a new approach. Intelligent fuzzing means that we only mutate specific parts of the input data, while the whole thing remains executable. So that would mean, for example, in an HTML document, we keep the structure. We keep like, we have like this parentheses and everything. We keep the structure. It's still a valid HTML document, but we only fuzz the elements. We fuzz the states of the elements and stuff like that. Yeah. So we fuzz stuff that is actually playable in real world and still works as a code, but it's not random. Yeah. So this is why we use Bamboo.js. But before we talk about this, I want to finalize this and say, if you start to fuzz browsers, you have to go for a different approach nowadays, and this is using JavaScript. So with JavaScript, you can do a lot. Basically, you could start with a simple HTML element, and it doesn't even have to be mutated or something. It can just be like your WordPress website. You click a Command S and save it, and you use this as a starter for your fuzzing. But with JavaScript, you do the actual mutations. So with JavaScript, you start to change element states. You start to resize elements, to add CSS, to remove CSS, to change names, to everything. So you basically do a wild mix of everything. And we can have a quick look at it. The fuzzer is open source, by the way, so everybody who's interested can download it later and have a look at it. But this is basically how this fuzzer is doing the main work. So we have like a lot of different states, and what it basically does, it finds all objects and it evaluates all possible methods for these objects and randomly applies them to other objects. So you will sometimes have states applied to objects that don't even support these states. And this is exactly what triggers the crash. So all these like semi-random fuzzing is much more dangerous for the browser, because it's still valid data, but you do stuff that the browser is absolutely not expecting. So you try to apply a state of a text area to for example, an image tag and stuff like that. And this tag is not even supported, yeah? Exactly. this is dumb fuzzing. So yeah, let's go back to the presentation. So I want to talk about Bamboo.js because before we dive deeper into the code, I would say everybody can just have a look at the code by himself. And yeah, we just stay on meta level. But if you have any questions for browser fuzzing or for the code itself, feel free to ask me later. So what is Bamboo.js? I built Bamboo.js 5 years ago for the purpose to find vulnerabilities in Safari. So I had the task to exploit Safari and get the code execution to execute shellcode in it. And I had to find vulnerabilities in Safari. And this is why I wrote this fuzzer. But later, I just realized that it can find vulnerabilities in every browser. So it can find vulnerabilities in Safari, Chrome and Firefox and Internet Explorer. And these vulnerabilities have been actually reported and stated as CVE. So all these vulnerabilities have been found with Bamboo.js, with the fuzzer. So the fuzzing engine is JavaScript-based and creates these semi-random mutations that we talked about. And basically, you run it in your browser and you just wait to crash. So if you have a lot of machines, run it on multiple machines. If you have a lot of computer power, put all the power in the fuzzing process. Because it takes time. So you cannot just run a fuzzer and get the exploitable crash after 10 minutes. I mean, it could happen if you're very, very lucky. This is just the power of randomness. But it's more unlikely to happen. So be prepared to wait months. Or even like, I don't know, like it can take you 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, 4 months, sometimes even longer. Yeah. So fuzzing is a, you have to be patient to be a fuzzer or to work with fuzzers. And yeah, just like I said, the code is open source on GitHub. Feel free to fork it and download it and find your own vulnerabilities. Okay, so now I want to show you a demo what is actually possible with these kind of attacks. And for this, we have a look at it. So we currently have a vulnerability in Google Chrome. And we have a look at it now. So the type of the vulnerability is a use after free vulnerability. To catch this up quickly, use after free means that we have an address in the memory which was already freed by our application, but the application still tries to access it. This could happen if I create an element in the document object model which is removed later, but after that another code is trying to access a state of this element. Yeah, so this is how the crash happens, because there's an address in the memory which is not accessible anymore, but the application still tries to access it. This is a very common vulnerability and it's called use after free. Yeah, and if you just have a look at the crash, it looks like this. So this is German now. It says, oh no. And there was a mistake with the website. There was an error with the website. Yeah. So this is basically what happens when your Chrome crashes. And if you are fuzzing and you see this, you can be happy, because this is like the first step into an exploitable vulnerability. Like I said, not every time, because there are still vulnerabilities that are not exploitable. And there are still vulnerabilities where not even a crash appears. So you have to find it with other tools, but we talk about this later. Google has their own tool for that. So yeah, so this is what happens with the simple crash. But I mean, this is nothing I can use to hack your company, right? So we go a step deeper and see what happens if we turn this crash into an exploit. So let me quickly catch up what it means to have like a vulnerability like this. It means that I can execute arbitrary code on your machine. So I can just like drop a Trojan horse on your machine. I can just like delete all your files. I can access your pictures. I have full access to your machine and I can execute any code that I want. And in this example, I'm going to launch a calculator, because this is like a pretty common example if you just like want to prove that you can actually execute code. But it doesn't mean that I can only execute a calculator with this attack. I can execute everything that I want. Yeah. So let's have a look at how that looks. So with this attack, I work with return-oriented programming. It's very technical, but if you have any questions, feel free to sit down and we make a session later. And this is how it looks like. boom. So we just executed the calculator out of Chrome, which should really, really not happen. And this means I can execute any code that I want, right? So in the next step, we're going to use this whole thing to grab data from SSL encrypted websites. But before we go to this next step, any questions about this so far? It's the current version, and all versions below are also vulnerable. So actually, every version is vulnerable right now. Yes. Actually, I did not participate in the bug bounty, so we are going to work with Chrome together on this to fix it. And right now, they're actually working on a patch. I'm not sure yet how much I will earn, but I think it will be more than 60k. More questions? So when the user is in restricted mode, I can still exploit it. So I have to write a different exploit code for every operating system. So the exploit code will be different for Windows. But the restriction is no problem for me, because the restriction doesn't stop browsers from being exploited. It just means you cannot get full administrative access. But with the attack I'm going to show, you don't even need administrative access. So you can access all data in the browser without being administrator on the machine. More questions? Or should we just proceed to the next step? All right, if there are no questions anymore, just feel free to ask me later if you just get an idea. After doing this, I was thinking about what would be like the most intelligent way to use this, to actually get the most out of it. So just like I said, I could use it now to drop a Trojan horse on your computer. But I mean, I'm not that interested in Trojan horses anymore, because they are very loud, so they're quite easy to detect in many cases. And I don't even need it, so I don't need to access pictures on your computer or files or whatever, because nowadays everybody's living in the cloud. All our files are on Google Drive, on Facebook, and on websites. So this is why hacking the browser is also interesting, because everything that you have is in the browser. Everything interesting is in the browser. Like your whole YouTube history is in the browser. All your Facebook messages are in the browser. Your WhatsApp is in the browser if you're using WhatsApp web. So this is everything I can access. And how we do this, we have a look at this now. So quick question. Who knows about SSL stripping or heard about SSL stripping before? Please raise your hand.
Quite a lot.
And who does know this SSL stripping doesn't work anymore? Please raise your hand. Yeah, because this was a game changer that it doesn't work anymore. And who changed the game? We talk about this later. But first, I want to explain everybody what is SSL stripping, so you actually understand it. SSL stripping is a technique which was first introduced by the hacker Moxie Marlinspike, who is a quite well-known hacker in the scene. And he created also the tool SSL strip, which is also open source, and everybody can download it. So how did this tool work? This tool, first of all, this tool has been used for years and was successfully working on Facebook and Google some years ago. So some years ago, I could just download this public tool, sit in a Starbucks, and see all the Facebook passwords from the users in the same Wi-Fi as me. And it would also work nowadays, but I'm gonna tell you why it doesn't work anymore. But this was a quite effective tool, and this was like the state of the art to attack HTTPS. Also, if you work with a penetration testing distribution like Kali or something like that, there's SSL strip pre-installed. So it has been used as a penetration testing tool for years to attack HTTPS. So let's talk about how it works. So back in the days, you had a lot of mixed content on websites. I mean, nowadays it's kind of enforced that you don't do it, because there are many warnings and errors in the browser if you do it. But back in the days, it was not that a big deal, because not everybody knew about SSL stripping. So It means if you are on a website which is using HTTPS and there are actually HTTP links either to the own website or to other websites and someone clicks on it, you can compromise this person because he's not using HTTPS anymore, he's using HTTP. And then what the tool does is it proxifies the whole website through a through a normal proxy and turns all the HTTPS links into HTTP links. So you still get the same content, but it's cached by a proxy, so you get it over HTTP. And if you log in on Facebook, it still works, but it's through the cached proxy, so I get your credentials. And this is how SSL stripping worked. So I hope this is clear. If it's not, feel free to ask me later. But basically SSL stripping is a proxy, or an SSL stripper is a proxy that turns all HTTPS links into HTTP links in the very first moment when you click an HTTP link on an HTTPS website. Yeah? And this is how SSL stripping worked. But now, this time is over. No SSL stripping anymore. And nowadays, you cannot really exploit SSL with public methods. And this is why it's so developed nowadays. And there's even like a state of the art that you have to use SSL. And we have something new, which is called HTTP Strict Transport Security. Who already heard about this? Please raise your hand. Cool. HTTP Strict Transport Security, for those who don't know it yet, is an enforcement for HTTPS, but not server-side. It's browser-side. So that means if you go to a website and in the very first moment you access it over HTTPS, your browser remembers that you were using HTTPS on this website and your browser enforces you to use this website over HTTPS. Your browser enforces you, not the website. So that means all these attacks don't work anymore because your browser is trying to load the website over HTTPS even if you have no internet connection because it's browser-side. Yeah, and this is why STS is so powerful and stopped all the SSL stripping attacks, because yeah, you cannot do anything against it when it's enforced by the browser. Till now, yeah. So let's have a look at what we can do. Just like I said, SSL stripping pretty much lost the combat against HSTS. So you can still download SSL strip and have a look at it. It's quite interesting to see how it works, also to learn it. I think there are also sandboxes where you can play around with it, but it doesn't work anymore in real life, so forget it. The nearest alternative would be if I hack your computer, for example, using a browser exploit, I could install my own custom certificate and use this to still sniff your traffic. But everybody who already tried this before knows that installing custom certificates is very, very obvious. So if you have like a tool for it, you will see it pretty fast, and it's easy to detect. So this is definitely not what I would do. And also, it doesn't work in any case. So you will have cases where you have a custom certificate, which is even signed, and it's pretty hard to get this thing signed, but you still get SSL errors. So this is also not reliable. And everything is against using custom certificates. Also, if you're not like the best Harvard mathematician and better than everybody in the world in mathematics, you should not really break an SSL encryption because I don't know anybody who's able to create a to break an SSL encryption by pure mathematics. So this is also not an option. And this is why we attack the weakest part, the browser window. Yeah. So let's go back. I just sent you my link, and you just opened it, and this triggered my Chrome exploit. Now I can execute any software on your computer, and what I'm going to do is a sniffer that gets the data right from the browser window. So it just like it has full access to the browser window, and strips the data out of the browser window. So let's have a look at how that looks like. Browser window sniffing. So Sun Tzu said, "The supreme art of war is to subdue the enemy without fighting." So we don't even deal with SSL, but we still break it. Browser window sniffing. So the browser window contains everything that we want. Password, credentials, bitcoins, pictures. You know, we already talked about this before. And manipulating the browser window means we cannot just read, but we can also write data. So I cannot just like access your Facebook message and WhatsApp, etc. I can also manipulate them. So if someone sends you a message, I can turn it into a completely different message and you will not even notice. If you are transferring bitcoins to another wallet, I can even change the wallet ID in the background and you not even notice it. So you do this transaction to the wallet of your friend and you put like 200 euros or whatever, you start the transaction and then you get the two-factor authentication on your phone and you don't even see it. You do the two-factor authentication and the money is disappeared. It's on my bank account now. Yeah, because I just swapped the coin. I just swapped the wallet ID to my wallet ID in the request in the browser, and you did not see it. But we're going to have a practical example after this. So why do we do this? The attack is invisible to the victim, and the SSL certificate remains completely valid. So we still have a green certificate, and everything looks great. Nobody is actually seeing that he's going to be attacked with this attack. And yeah, there are many, many things we can do with this. Maybe you even have more ideas than me. So we can get access to personal instant messages, browsing history, online banking, passwords in clear text, and much more. Also, a very interesting thing are password managers. I will not ask the question now who's using a password manager, but if you're using a password manager, many of them have like this master password. So if you type it, and you only have to type it one time per session, because otherwise you would have to type it every time you click on it. There's like this plugin, and you see all your passwords. You can also get this with browser sniffing. So if you just like use a password manager with browser sniffing, I can get all your passwords in clear text.
Demo.
Yeah. So how does it look like? We're going to have a look. So in the first example, we are starting with, let me quickly fix the screen thing because somehow my screen is now doubled. All right, that's much better. So, yeah, let's have a look at an example. So we go to bbc.com, and yeah, now this website is doesn't use HTTPS, but we are also going to do it on HTTPS website. Why I choose BBC, you're going to see it now. So basically, we start with replacing stuff. So yeah, just like I said, we have a full man in the middle attack, so we can replace content, but we can also sniff content. And let's see how it looks like. So the attack that I will now show will replace everything where it says Trump with Hillary. But since on this website, there's not, I mean, when I was visiting this website in the morning, there was Trump everywhere, now not anymore. So this is why I also replaced the pictures. And let's have a look how it looks like. So now the website looks like this. And this is what happens on the victim device. So, I mean, this is now super obvious and it's not really an attacker would do with your device, but I could also just change a specific headline. I could also just change a specific message. I mean, you get the point, right? So I have full access to this website and I can manipulate the contents by just accessing straight the browser window. Yeah. So now you say this website is not HTTPS. Okay, then let's go on Google. So we search for Trump. And we have Donald Hillary, looks like this. It says Trump's doesn't get catched, but everything where it says Trump, you see it's now replaced with Hillary. Donald John Hillary was born on 14th June. Yeah, so this is how it looks like. Hillary's everywhere. And I mean, this is just like a super simple example, but imagine what you can do with this attack. You can just like, I mean, this is replacing data, yeah? So we started with replacing data. Replacing data means I just manipulate your message, your bitcoins or whatever. But now let's come to reading data, yeah? This is the next interesting thing. can we actually hijack data on HTTPS websites? And the certificate is still okay. So it says your connection is secure. Yeah. And the next thing we are going to do is actually reading data. And for this, I want to go on Yahoo. So we have like the big websites covered. And let's start with a simple search. And for this, we're going to use a server. So in this case, the attacker is running a server, which waits for data to get sent to, and the exploit sends all the data, or the tool sends all the data to the attacker server. So first, we start a server. The next thing we start is the attack. All right. So please tell me something I search for on this HTTPS encrypted website. Just any topic you would like.
InfoSec.
All right. That's a good topic. And we hit the search thingy. So now we see in our logger that it actually got locked. And if we have a look at the output, you will see we just searched for InfoSec. Yeah? So I can get everything from the browser. We can also do it real time. So we can just like do a tail. And something else I can search for? What's your favorite word?
I don't know. The SSID conference. Sorry? This conference.
Okay, then we search for this conference. And now we should be able to see it in real time. Not in this case, but here you see it. This conference. So, of course, this does not only work for Yahoo, it works for every website. So, if you want to see it on a different website, just let me know. But I think this should be enough as a proof of concept. And as you can see, everything remains untouched. So, the victim doesn't even know that he or she gets attacked. And this is what I drop on the target machine, yeah, like in research. I not do this to actually attack people, but this is what an attacker would do. So an attacker would use the Chrome exploit to drop the sniffer, and in the background, everything that you do in the browser gets sent to him. Any questions?
Yes.
It also works in private mode. You want to see it? Okay, so we go to Yahoo. Do you have another website that I can use? Like any website for the Hillary example, for example? It could also be like a website from your company or something. Okay, how do I type this? Double S? .com. All right. Beautiful website. Let's check this out. Maybe we can make it even more beautiful. All right. So, yeah, this will be another example, but let's go back to the search. And this is private mode now, yeah, so you see, private. Let's run this again. Okay, now, anything I can search for? Wait, directly, sorry, but I just demonstrate and then I come back to your question, okay? So, please tell me a word.
Cat images.
Sorry?
Cat photos.
How do we write this?
Cat, like an animal.
Ah, okay. All right. Just like this? All right. So here you can see it. Cat. And this is private mode. All right. So yes, your question, please. Yeah, so yeah, so exactly. So the only connection between the victim and the attacker is when I do this logging. So the first attack is completely invisible and there's no way to detect it. Absolutely no way. In this way, of course, this data has to get transferred somehow to the hacker. So this is why I use like a server where these strings are going to be sent and stored in a text file. Yeah. So you could actually monitor this if the application is sending data to another server. But this is also super hard to monitor because I could just get a free web hosting on WordPress or on Google and it looks like totally legitimate. So yeah, just to state this, I mean, today I didn't want to show like a super simple attack which is easy to detect, because this attack is super hard to detect and there are no automated ways to actually see this attack.
Yes.
I mean, of course, you could look in the processes, but if you talk about server-side detection, of course there's nothing because it gets written directly into the browser. The process, yeah, I mean, okay, I can show, what I can show you is, okay, so it doesn't even get showed in the processes. This whole attack is using OSA script. This is like a scripting language on Mac, and on Windows I use PowerShell, and in this case it doesn't even, it's not even in your process list, so you don't see it in the process list. It's running, but you don't see it in the process list. Because, I mean, so the point about this is, I just know, because I know why it doesn't get showed. Because it's not like it's a running process that's running the whole time. It's like it gets executed every second, every second, every second, and then it stops again. Because it has to be executed on every website individually. So this is why there's like a script running and it's executed every time, but then it stops again. So there's no like a running process. Maybe we can find it when we are very fast. Yes, yes, there it is. So this is how it looks like. But I mean, how would this be detectable for you? I mean, like, I wouldn't detect it by myself either. This is like super sneaky. The only thing you can see actually is this. But also this, I can make undetectable. Of course, you can hide the process. So this is not what I worried about. But if I hide the process, you see nothing about this attack anymore. It remains super invisible. Antivirus doesn't detect anything either. No behavior detection for this, because it's actually exploiting a zero day with the Chrome exploit, so this doesn't get detected. Antivirus can only detect exploits that are already public. Ah, you mean like monitoring the processes? Yeah, but actually this is bypassable, so this is not really a protection. I can just like run a process which is running the whole time and make it invisible. So, yeah, but good point. Yes? Sorry? The attack? In this case, the attack would stop after a reboot, so I didn't make the malware out of it. But of course, I can make it persistent. This is actually what I was just working on this morning, because what you see here is Node Auto Start. This is like an auto start plugin for Node.js, so I just wanted to make it persistent, and so I'm going to say it's persistent tomorrow. Yes. Super fast. So Google is already knowing my work on our work, and yeah, we have a pretty good contact to them, and I have to say, Google has a very, very good incident incident management. They react super fast to security breaches, especially if it's, I mean, okay, Google is like this. If you send them an exploit, which is just proof of concept, you cannot show that you can actually abuse this, you will get nothing for it and they will not invest much time in it. But if you can actually show them that you bypass their sandbox and execute your own code, then they take it very serious and get in touch with you fast. So I was getting the reply not even in an hour. Any more questions? Yes. Which login credentials? I mean, okay, it's not really necessary to ask this question because you can capture. Ah, okay. So do you want to do it on a specific site so I can show you? Because this works for every website. So I can capture your Facebook credentials. I can capture your YouTube credentials. I can capture whatever. So, hello at riga.com. Hello, Riga. And here we are on Facebook. You want to see mock samples or? Of course, you can sniff all the cookies. So you can just access document.cookie. But I mean, instead of sniffing cookies, I directly get the passwords. So I don't even have to deal with replacing cookies and stuff like that. But of course, it's also possible. So just to repeat, you can get everything out of the browser. You can get all the cookies. You can even get the browser history. Yeah, everything, basically. Sorry, I don't really... Ah, yeah, of course. Yeah, of course, of course. I mean, you can even like open websites in the background by using iframes and get all the data at the same time. Yeah, so this is what you can do. Yes. No, not at all. This attack doesn't deal with certificates because it directly accesses the browser window. Everything is executed in the browser window, and this is why the certificate remains completely untouched. Yes. Right now, only Google can stop. Okay, so we talk without the exploit, right? Okay, so this is pretty hard because, yeah. Yeah, I mean, the only data that gets sent is the data that is sniffed, right? So, and I can set this data encrypted too, so you don't really get this data. And I don't even have to send the data. I can also save it somewhere. I can send the post request to a completely different website, like I said, like on WordPress.com or something, and you don't even see it. So you can remain it invisible. Yes? Yes, in this case it would work, but I have to say, with the Chrome exploit, I can just enable it again. But it's a good approach, definitely. But I would say, like, if you disable JavaScript, using the internet is not fun anymore in 2018, so... yes. Yeah, you can bypass the content security policy by creating an image, and this is what I do. So what I do is, let me give you a quick code example. So you're right, I cannot send data from one site to another site, but let me show you how you can still do it. So this is a one-liner of JavaScript. This looks like two lines, but it's a line break from my software. So it's a one-liner. that makes you able to transfer data from one website to another website, even when content security policy is enabled. Because what I do here is I create a new image, but this image is actually pointing to my logger script, and the browser thinks it's a normal image, so it's loading it as an image, but the data still gets logged, and this is how the tool does it. Any more questions? Yes. No, it does not inject into JavaScript files. It really injects directly into the browser window, so it injects into the WebKit. No files at all. All right. Sorry? Right now, I don't know. I mean, like, the Google team is working with all their resources on it, and I think they're going to fix it pretty fast. So in the next version, I think it should be fixed. Yes, of course. Oh, this is the clean one. So, okay, I just stopped the attack and then just close all the things here. Make a new window. Yeah. So this is the version 6.9.3.4.9.7. Yeah, but I mean, there was an update in the meanwhile. We can also update it and I show you the same attack. Will not make a difference. So, yeah, any more questions? Yeah, so basically you have to be very careful which links you click on, because with a browser attack, everything it needs you to click on a link. And the dangerous thing about this is, sometimes it's not only the links. So sometimes when you are on a forum or something, discussion, a web board, where you can ask questions like Stack Overflow, in many of these platforms you can include images and you can include sometimes even iframes. And this means every website could potentially attack you. But if you just want to mitigate it as good as possible, be very careful with the links you click on. Don't click on every link, and especially don't open emails from person you don't know. So this is like the default things. But in general, since this is a zero-day exploit, it's very hard to protect against it. So I have to say this is the job of the Google team to do this and not of the end user, because this is a vulnerability in Google software. But yeah, if you just want to mitigate it as good as possible, be very careful with the links. Yeah, that would be a good idea. If you have like a sandbox for opening links, you could actually make it much safer. Or you could also use a virtual machine, but now we're talking about things that really getting the comfort from using it away. I mean, not everybody is going to use a virtual machine to open links, so, but this would be an option, of course. Yes? Of course. I mean, Google Ads, they have their own methods to validate if it's like a scam or something. So I'm not sure if you can earn money with it, but I think if you work long enough with it, you can use this to spread your Google Ads. Ah, okay. I'm not sure if this is possible, because I don't think you can actually use HTML code in Google Ads. All right, so any more questions? Yes. Right now, the only thing you can do is, like I said, you can disable OSA script on your MacBook, but this is not really a protection, because then there are other ways to do this attack, and also I can enable it again with the Chrome exploit. So if we talk about this specific combination, it's very, very hard to protect against it. I think the only way to really protect against is using a virtual machine and browse with that. No. No, absolutely not. On Windows, the attack works as well. So, like I said, in Windows, I use PowerShell instead of OSA script. It's the same, basically. Yeah, but I mean, you can also install Chrome on Windows, right? Sorry? Yeah, but true, this attack is only working in Chrome that I showed right now. But yeah, you can also find same vulnerabilities in Internet Explorer or in Safari or something. So I also reported vulnerabilities in Safari. Basically, the fuzzer was written for Safari, so it's more like it was lucky that I saw, okay, it also works with other browsers well. And yeah, but I mean, right now, if you use Internet Explorer, you will not be exploited with this attack. But I mean, Internet Explorer is also a very how can I say it? It's very hacker like it as target. Yeah. Sorry? I didn't fuzz it yet, so it would be interesting. Maybe this is the next project to have a look at. But I have to say, Microsoft bug bounties are not so reliable, so I'm not sure if I'm going to do this, but if you download Bamboo, you can just start fuzzing Edge and maybe you find the vulnerability. It's affecting WebKit right now, but the exploit only works in Chrome currently. So other WebKit browsers are not affected apart from Chromium. It also works in Chromium because Chrome is based on the Chromium engine. In the mobile version, it's also possible, but then I have to adjust the payload because this payload is for a computer. It's not for an ARM device. To what? To find it? I mean, there are multiple months of fuzzing behind this. So I was running fuzzers on multiple computers with high power. And then the fuzzing is just like half of the work. After that, you have to find out which crashes are actually exploitable. So this is the next part, took me also several weeks. And then in the last 2 or 3 weeks, I was writing the whole exploit. So the good thing was that I was already able to bypass the sandbox because I already knew how to bypass the Chrome sandbox. And I could just reuse it in this example. So I was focusing on exploit writing and finding crashes. But yeah, I think all in all, it's definitely a lot of time I put in. Right now I'm not sure what I get for it, but it will be, I think it's, I cannot really say numbers right now, but it will be okay for me. All right, so any more questions? Okay.